Hi, Juliana. Great to have you here today. To my just passing through with JP Olson. Hi, Wilma's. Yes, it's good to see each of you here. It's just a blessing. I'm just looking here to see why my delay is coming on, but that's okay. God is good. Hi, Wilma's and Geraldine, and just a blessing to have each one of you here today. Hi, Linda from Canton, Georgia. Each one of you, we're so happy to have you here. Bless you with love and happiness. Hi, Tina from Texas. Hi, Kelly. Yes, God is good. It's a blessing to just see faithful followers. Hi, Celine from Perry, Georgia. Colleen from New Mexico. Yes, Lord, you're the one that guides my heart. We thank you, Lord, for our blessings. We thank you, Lord, for this day. For this is a day you have made, Lord. And we shall and we will rejoice and be glad in it. If we have anyone here for the first time that's on, we want to welcome you here. Yes, hope today is blessed. Yes, it is. We're going to claim it's a blessing, London. We're going to claim it's a blessing already. But those of you who may be here for the first time, we want you to stay connected with us. We have ways to stay connected with us. And so we got our platforms, our Instagram, our Twitter, our Facebook, our YouTube, our Pinterest. Ways to stay connected with us, and then our website, where you can go to our website and you can go on there, you can complete a prayer request form. We love to pray on Mondays. We come together and pray, and we do our inspirational readings to encourage you through the week. Sign up for that, and you just can go and look at the website and see what we're doing in the ministry, our outreach ministry, Hi Divine from Memphis. Then we have our Bible study. Is the Bible study so good, we're going to go through the summer with the Bible study. We're not going to take a break. We're going to go through the summer with the Bible study. And then we're always back here for our just passing through. Just words of encouragement. Words of encouragement to help you get through the week. Because we know God is good. The goodness of God keeps running after us. And he looked beyond all of our faults. And he see our needs. And so we're just going to share that word today. And then those of you who are, the music you hear is mine. If you're here for the first time, you can order it from my website or from Amazon. You can order a track. We just glorify God, the goodness of God. And we just thank each one of you again for coming, taking time out on Wednesday to come and be a part of this ministry. And then you know about our giving. We don't want to beg. We just put it out there and say, Lord, touch their hearts and sow. And I'm so grateful and blessed for those of you who are on here who have sown into the ministry so that we can get on that TV broadcast. God is so good. You've done it. You did it. And we thank you. We ask others who haven't given, come on and jump in there with the others. And hi, Claudia from North Carolina. So we want to bless you again. And I think I've covered all the message on how to stay in touch with everything. Saturday is our, we're going to do communion. So Saturday will take place on communion, and I'll share more to you what will be going on next week. So we just thank you again. We bless you. It's 106, so we want to jump right into the message of what is going on, what God is doing, and just to be blessed. All right, so we have all the information here. Geraldine will put everything here in the content so that you can, in the comment box, and you can see what is actually going on. So we thank you, and we bless you again with love and happiness as we come together. And we just thank God for his mercy, his goodness, and his mercy. And we thank him for that. And so, Father, we're here today. We come, Lord, to just bless you for all you have done and all that you're doing. We thank you. So, what is our message? Let's jump right into the message. I look on Wednesday. Wednesday is my day of encouraging each person. So I didn't want to go too deep. I wanted to save that for Saturday. And let's talk about what's the story behind their ruins. What's the story behind their ruins? In 1 Kings 9, chapter 9, verse 6 through 9. It says in Psalm 38, 17 and 20 in the Messenger Bible. It says, I'm on the edge of losing it. The pain in my gut keeps burning. I'm ready to tell my story of failure. Anybody that knows me know how much I love dogs, okay? I have a dog right now, and you all know that. You probably hear him passing through every now and then. You see, I've had them ever since I can remember, and every breed, every size, I've had them, Dalmatian and all. Every time I see a dog, whether walking down the street or the road where I am or whatever in the park, or if I'm in the car, I instantly turn into a five-year-old. I really do. Just scream and say, oh, can I have him? He looks so pretty. In a nutshell, I love dogs. Okay, it's that simple. However, I've never met a pup quite like my friend Pup, and I talked about him some time ago, a Yorkie. He's a Yorkie. His name is Bella. And you see, Bella wasn't very easy to get to know. We know some people like that. You can say, well, they kind of like at a distance. They kind of like evasive when they talk, you know. She was such a cute little dog. She was a cute pie, I would call it, a cute little pie. She was so little and so adorable, but not approachable at all. So in my experience, most dogs run up to you when you come to the door, even if you're a stranger, and they're usually all over you, but not Bella. She ran the other way, and she cowered in the corner somewhere. No matter how gentle, no matter how friendly you were to her, it didn't matter. As soon as she saw someone coming, she ran in the opposite direction. She refused to come out of her corner for anybody. Strange, she was a strange little dog. But I thought, however, that wasn't until my friend explained that Bella had been terribly abused by her first owner. So when she saw people, she saw pain. You couldn't understand the way Bella acted until you knew her story. Believe it or not, most people are like that too. Hi, LaRonda. Hi, Tower. Let us know where you're from, and so we can acknowledge you properly. And thank you for joining the family here on Wednesday. I'd like to know where you're from. Okay, you see, you watch how people act. You watch how they treat people. Okay? I couldn't understand Bella's, the puppy's reaction. But I didn't know the story until my friend told me her story. So believe it or not, people are like that too. You watch how they act, how they treat people. You see the bad attitude they have, and you say, I don't know what's wrong with his or her problem. I don't have to deal with her foolishness or his foolishness. I don't know why he woke up on the wrong side of the bed today, but I would not be treated like this. I would not be treated like I was his aggravating alarm clock that disturbed his beauty sleep. Or you respond with the same garbage they just dished out to you. So often we judge people with little distorted or no information at all. We just judge them. We see what they do and we assume that's who they are. But rarely is that ever the case. Rarely is that ever the case for people. I've discovered that the make a difference people in the world, the healers, are the ones who never forget this critical issue in dealing with people. You can't understand the way they act until you know their story. And everybody's got a story. It may have a different heading. Most of them are all alike. Maybe a different heading, different topic. But we all got a story. I got a story. You got a story. We all have stories. I've discovered that most people, these people, and people in the world, the healers and the ones who never get the critical issue in dealing with people, you can't understand why people act like they act until you know their story. Stop concerning yourself with what they're drinking and what they're smoking and how long they've been fornicating and how many tattoos and piercings they have, why the marriage ended, why they didn't finish school, why they left the church. We concern ourselves with so much stuff. Why they dress the way they do, or why they have five kids with three different baby daddies, a whole lot of stuff. Concern yourself more so with helping them to write their new chapter instead of being stuck rereading their last one. The Bible is clear. It says, get rid of all bitterness, all rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. That's in Ephesians 4:31, which for many of us, that has been a response to their deeds. But instead, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as Christ and God forgave you. That's in verse 32 in the NIV Bible. That's how we'll respond if we cooperate. Trying to understand there are needs beneath those deeds. There's a history behind those hang-ups. And I think about the young man that we had hired to do work in the house. And my husband got so frustrated with him. He said, no, I don't want him to come back. Don't call him back. And I knew in my spirit, and just even having that experience and skills in counseling and background in psychology, psychotherapy, stuff like that, I knew something was going on with him. And I just told my husband, no, let's just keep it. And I even got upset with him several times, just different things. And so one day I just, you know, I talked about him. I talked to him and I just asked him about his life. And he had a very, very thick stutter, very thick speech impediment. He stuttered like Moses did. And it was, I hadn't heard anybody stutter like that in a long time. And he just had a lot of different things going on with him. And like he didn't care about things and just doing things useless and whatever. And so I talked to him and I asked him just about himself, his background, and just talked to him even about his stuttering. I said, when he would start talking, I said, just wait a minute, just take your time. Slow down. You can do it. I said, you can do it. And finally he started doing it. I said, when you get anxious and excited, just pause. I said, and then your word's going to just come out. And then we got to talking about his background. And he said, I'm like the way I am because I've always been just considered the lost one in the family. And he said, I've done a lot of things. He said, but the speech problem caused me, you know, and I was a little slow in school and people picked on me all the time. And so I, you know, did a lot of things to try this peer pressure. The bullies were after me all the time and I didn't have this. And so I made a lot of mistakes and I got on drugs and I started doing things and I was acting out in rebellious and I was left just on, you know, my mother said, no, I'm not going to deal with you anymore. So they put me out. I was homeless and just all kind of things he was telling me. And this happened and that happened. And I got this girl pregnant and she was, you know, had to go to prison for drugs and just a lot of different things he was sharing with me. And so I said, you know, you're going to be all right. And then I asked him about the Bible. And he's the one I mentioned to you before that I gave him a Bible. He never had a Bible. And I gave him one and we would go through the scriptures every day. You see, my husband's ready to judge him. You know, he's just a misfit. He's just a reject, whatever. And I said, no, it's something behind those ruins. Hi, Victoria. Something behind those ruins. And so, you know, we prayed and we talked and he started changing. And I saw things changing. He's been more responsible and just changing. And I saw him one day at the store. And he said, JP, you helped me so much. He said, you helped me so much. He said, and I thought about you, said about your self-worth. And I started getting in the word. And he said, I'm doing so much better. Because I was lost. I was just in a world lost. And so we never know. We never know what is happening. My dog is barking in the background. He very seldom barks. And so I'm going to probably have to just put it on outside. I really apologize for that. You all just give me 1 second because I'm going to have to get him outside because he's barking. And I really hate to do this, but it is what it is. Give me 1 second. I got to put him out. I pray this will never happen again. There was an Amazon guy. Hi, Christy. Amazon guy kept knocking and knocking. So I apologize about that. Let me just get back into my message here. So I was sharing with you about the young man. And we never know. We're so quick to judge. We never know a person's background, a person's life, what has happened. So God said in the Bible, as I just shared, get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. In Ephesians 4:31, which for many of us, that is our response to their deeds. But instead, we need to be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as Christ and God forgave you in verse 32. That's how we'll respond if we cooperate. Trying to understand there are needs beneath those deeds. There's a history behind those hangups. I remember discovering how wrong I had been about some of the women in a leadership group. And this has been some years back. Yes, Christy, I had to put him out, and you all just forgive me. I should know better to get him out before I start. Okay, so after many of these women poured out their hearts at a women's retreat, late into the night, people you thought you knew reveal the pain in their background. Some of the women who were distant had been physically and mentally and verbally and sexually abused. And some of the women who had bad attitudes suffered from varying mental illnesses such as depression. And some of the women who dogged men out were in relationships that treated them like property instead of like a person. And some of the women who didn't like to be a part of our social gatherings were actually ex-alcoholics. And although we didn't have alcohol there, but just being in a gathering, you're in a setting of women just sharing things, just laughing and joking and having fun and listening to music, it gave them urges to need a drink, since that was mostly the setting when they did drink. They were simply trying to avoid the triggers that have shot them in the past. Yes, Christy, as you said, they're seeing people the way God sees them. In other words, suddenly the lights went on. And I said to myself, so that's what I've been seeing all these years. It's nothing to do with their personality, just their personal, private, painful paths. I felt bad that I had been responding to them based on their deeds and never considered the needs behind their deeds. It reminds me of parenting my children when they were babies. I could deal with them crying because they were hungry or wet. But it was those times when they would cry, and for the life of me, I couldn't figure out what they were crying about that drove me nuts. There were times I felt like I was having a panic attack because I couldn't figure out why they were crying. Me and my mom had a little chat, and that was back in the day before she passed, after those, and she said, every cry has a story behind it. Am I on now? Can you all see me? Somebody said I'm off. But I hope you can see me now. Every cry has a story behind it. Some chapters are quick and you find out right away. But then some you have to wait it out. You have to wait it out until chapter 4 before you figure it out. Am I on? I'm just reading what I see here. Someone said that I've gone off air. And I'm just trying to see, am I back on? Do you all see me? Geraldine hasn't said anything, so I just wanted to know. Okay, so here we go. Let me just share this again. Talking about the deeds. Talking about the women. And I hope that you all caught me on that. I'm on back on. Okay, good, back on. I hope it was just for a second, but let me just share this just in case. I remember discovering... Geraldine is letting you know what to do if you're going off. I remember discovering how wrong I had been about some of the women in the leadership group. And I don't know if you've got this or not. I'm going to repeat it. After many of them poured out their hearts at a women's retreat, late into the night, people you thought you knew revealed the pain in their backgrounds. And some of the women who were distant were physically, mentally, verbally, and sexually abused. And some of the women who had bad attitudes suffered from varying mental illnesses such as depression. And some of the women who dogged men out were in relationships that treated them like property instead of like a person. Some of the women who didn't like to be a part of our social gatherings were actually ex-alcoholics. And although our events had no alcohol at them, for them, just being in a place with a lot of people, laughing, joking, having fun, listening to music, all gave them urges to need a drink. Since that was mostly the setting when they had drinks. They were simply trying to avoid the triggers that have shot them in the past. In other words, suddenly for me, the lights went on. And I said, so that's what I've been seeing all these years. It had nothing to do with their personality, just their personal, private, painful past. I felt bad that I had been responding to them based on their deeds. And never considered the needs before their deeds. It reminds me, as I was saying, of my children, parenting my babies or my children when they were babies. I could deal with them crying because they were hungry or wet. But it was those times when they would cry, and for the life of me, I couldn't figure out why they were crying, what they were crying about. That drove me nuts. There were times when I felt like I was really having a panic attack because I couldn't figure out why they were crying. me and my mom, like I say, years ago, she was here with us, chatted about those days, and we chatted about those days, and she said, listen, every cry has a story behind it. Some chapters are quick, and you find out right away, but then some, you have to wait it out until chapter 40 before you can figure it out. Either way, every cry has a story behind it. I have no idea what made me recall that today, but that's what brought out this message I'm sharing. And I think because there's so many crying, there's so much brokenness, there's so many people hurting, and when we get the prayer request, we get a lot of divorces, and rarely is it the man saying, save my marriage. Very rarely. The majority, we may have one or two come through, but the majority of the time it's the women asking God to save their marriage, to send their husband back, to pray. You know, they've been hurt, they've been broken, they've been abused physically, mentally, sexually. So I thought about so much brokenness, and I talked about that on the other week, and I thought, Lord, I want words of encouragement that I can encourage some of the women. I can encourage the men. I can encourage everyone that's on today. And the truth is, there are some people that we meet daily in our homes, in our churches, in our work, our school, our supermarket, our laundromat, hair and nail salon, that are crying. But unfortunately, we get so frustrated because we don't know why they're crying, that we simply ignore the cry, or we wait for someone else to come and pick them up and figure it out. I can't even imagine the number of people who have left our churches because they were crying, and no one took the time and patience to figure out why. We were so busy being frustrated by the noise of their behavior and their attitude and their ways and words that we didn't listen for the story behind the act of crying. Now, I know there's a difference. Some of y'all probably said, well, they're just some people that just needy people. They just want to tie you up all the time. There's always something. And there are those people, too. There are those people, too, who just have that need to do that. And I'm not saying there are some people that are actually crying and need our attention. But we're so busy, we don't listen for the story behind the act of crying. The problem is we're too busy reacting instead of listening, which recalls Ephesians 4, beginning with verse 29. He says, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. That's in the NIV Bible. Sometimes, that's why I said we have to shut down people who start talking about people. We don't know. Some of us haven't walked in their shoes. We don't know what has happened. Let's, as my custom view, this verse in a few translations, just listen to some of these verses in a few translations that we have. It says, do not let wholesome, foul, profane, worthless, vulgar words ever come out of your mouth, but only such speech as is good for building up others according to the need and occasion, so that it will be a blessing to those who hear. When you talk, don't say anything bad, but say the good things that people need. Whatever will help them grow stronger, then what you say will be a blessing to those who hear you. That's in the ERV Bible. Watch your talk. No bad words should be coming from your mouth. Say what is good. Your words should help others grow as Christians. In other words, don't say things that will tear a person down. Only things that will build that person up. Why? Because you're focusing on their needs, not their deeds. The word need is defined as something required because it is essential or very important, expressing necessity or obligation, circumstances in which a thing or course of action is required. And despite what their deeds may have been, there were needs that they steamed from, that were needs that steamed from problems or situations in their life. If only we would take the patience and time to figure them out. And according to scripture and the very definition of the word need, this is what God is requiring of us as essential for them. You see, you often hear me say, God looked beyond our faults and he saw our needs. Such amazing grace. That he would look beyond our faults and see our needs. And this is what we're doing. Look beyond their faults. Things have happened in their life. Maybe yes, but they keep rewriting the same story. We have to help them. Let's leave this page. Let's leave this page here. Listen, whether that person is your child, your spouse, your parent, your friend, your coworker, or someone at church, their response is more about their need than their deed. And no matter what their response, your reaction is to meet their need. You are to love them enough to listen to their story until you find the chapter they're stuck in that needs requiring your help. Are you obligated to do that? I say myself, absolutely. You are your brothers and sisters keeper in John 13:35. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love and unselfish concern for one another. That's in the Amplified Bible. The Message Bible says it like this. Let me give you a new command. Love one another in the same way I love you. You love one another. This is how everyone will recognize that you are my disciples, when they see the love you have for each other, in verse 34 and 35. Then 1 John 4:20-21 declares, if anyone boasts, I love God, and goes right on hating his brother or sister, thinking nothing of it, he is a liar. The Bible says that. If he won't love the person that he can see, how can he love the God that he can't see? That's in the Word of God. The command we have from Christ is blunt. Loving God includes loving people. You've got to love both. You don't get to pick and choose who you love. You don't get to pick and choose that. God said love them all. We have to help them by saying, okay, we keep hearing the same chapter, but wait a minute, hold up. Some people, yes, they're going to get offended because some people can't handle that. But you say it anyway. You're trying to help them. You just say, okay, you will never get past this chapter if you keep rehearsing it. Even if you keep rehashing history, you'll never get past that page. And this is, you can say it with compassion. Look, let me try to help you. We're going to close that chapter so we can get you over here, so we can see results. But you're staying in this chapter. You won't leave it. It's the same old, and you have people like that all over the world. And you have to say, it's not that I don't want to hear you, but you can't get, I'm trying to help you to get over here because you're stuck in your past and you're not there now. You're not there anymore. And no matter how badly they've acted, you must love them enough to hear their story and be concerned enough to help them write a new chapter. You can't love God and not love people. God himself says what? He calls us a liar. But you and I can help them get out of that chapter. And if they get upset and mad, okay, we tried. We did our part. It's up to them. Listen, if you knew their story, you'd understand why many have been made to feel worthless much of their life. So they make choices since they're viewed as trash by some, especially those closest to them. And that's one of the hardest battles to be won, is helping a person get past their past. That's a hard one. Some people don't want to get past their past. Hi, Grace. Some people do not want to get past their past. I mean, really, you probably say, well, how is that, JP? Because some people love to complain. Some people love to do that. They don't want to get past their past. And that's why I say it's the hardest battle to be won, is helping a person get past their past and to forget what they keep recalling. You must love them forward. Your love for your brothers and sisters needs to be progressive, which is defined as proceeding gradually or in stages, engaging in or constituting of forward motion. I hear people who, in their second marriages or if their third marriages, they'll say they can't even get the marriage where it should be because the other person keeps rehashing the problem they have in the old marriage. I say if you bring your old bricks from the old house to the new house, you're going to build the same house that you just left. Because you're bringing those old, same old bricks to build a new house, new relationship, and you're building the same house, the same problems you had before. So you have to help them move forward. Your love for your brothers and sisters needs to be progressive, which is defined as proceeding and gradually or in stages, engaging or in constituting forward motion. They will net forward motion. They will never get to where they need to be if they remain stuck where they are. And sometimes that means we must be their pen of inspiration. Hi, Safraz. And when they feel the horror story is how it ends, we need to step up to the desk and say, oh no, it's not. That's not how the story ends. That chapter may end like that, but that's not how your story will end. There's another chapter in you. And we're going to write that chapter out. Because you're not there anymore. We're not looking in the rearview mirror at the past. That's why it's called a rearview mirror. You're not looking back. You're looking forward. Where are you going? There's another chapter in you. And you tell them, we're going to help you write it out. They need to know that their chapter doesn't die here. It doesn't die here. This is not the final chapter. The story is not over. No matter how they act, you are responsible to stay in character. Never act out of character. Now, if we're being honest here, we've all been in situations where we wanted to, or some of us did, treat other people the same way they treated us. After all, no one smiles at the person they have the door open for, and when they walk through, they never parted their lip to say thank you. No one is happy about a person they've helped that treats them harshly in return. But does that give you reason, justification, license, or excuses for us to act out of character? We probably say it. Sometimes I say, you know, you don't know what the person went through. And sometimes you want to say, you know what, they come at me, I'm coming back at them the same way. And then you think about it before you say something. I have to sometimes I say, okay, let me count to 10. Let me not get out of character. I don't know, they could have had a bad day. They could have had a bad night. Something could have gone wrong. So I'm just going to stay in character and just give them a smile and say thank you. Have a nice day. Because no one is happy about a person they've helped. And they treat them harshly in return. But does that give us a reason, a justification, license, excuse for us to act out of character? Absolutely not. Ephesians 4:26-27 says this. Go ahead and be angry. You do well to be angry. But don't use your anger as fuel for revenge. And don't stay angry. Don't go to bed angry. Don't give the devil that kind of foothold in your life. That's in the Messenger Bible. Then Matthew 18:21-22 shares. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, when someone won't stop doing wrong to me, how many times must I forgive them? 7 times? Jesus answered, I tell you, you must forgive them more than 7 times. You must continue to forgive them even if they do wrong to you 77 times. Can you imagine that? But that's how God does us. He's a perpetual forgiving God. He sees us mess up. But Peter said, 7 times, Lord? He said, Peter, you must continue to forgive them even if they do wrong to you 77 times. Romans 12:17-19. Don't hit back. Discover beauty in everyone. If you've got it in you, get along with everybody. Thank you, Wilmers. I'm trying to get some out, but don't insist on getting even. That's not for you to do. I'll do the judging, says God. I'll take care of it. He's the ultimate judge. That's in the Messenger Bible. I'm just about to wrap up here. And my personal favorite, it's Matthew 5:38-42. It says, here's another old saying that deserves a second look. An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Is that going to get us anywhere? Here's what I propose. Don't hit back at all. If someone strikes you, stand there and take it. If someone drags you into court and sues for the shirt off your back, gift wrap your best coat and make a present of it. And if someone takes unfair advantage of you, use the occasion to practice the servant life. No more tit for tat stuff. Live generously because God got it. God got it. He said, vengeance is mine anyway. If someone want to keep bothering you for no nonsense, are you getting this? Your only reaction in their response is to love. You must step in their shoes. After all, that's what intercessors do. They fill the gap. They step in the middle. They carry a load that's killing somebody else. And some people travail for others. And truth is, maybe their story includes some awful hurt that has turned them hard just so they won't get hurt anymore. You know people build these bridges and you wonder why you can't break through. They want to make sure, and they'll say it, I want to make sure I don't get hurt again. I want to make sure of that. And so maybe there are some morally dark chapters in their past that can make them critical and legalistic today because they hate what they used to be. They may wound because they've been wounded. You know, we hear the saying, hurt people hurt people, okay? And God raised up, God sent people out that have been rescued. He uses rescued people to rescue people. Their wounds, they may wound because they've been wounded. We hear that all the time. But remember, hurt people hurt people. Somewhere behind the way they act is a story of a perfectionist parent. Trust lost because of abuse. The absence of a father's love. Abandonment, failure, tragedy, and the like. So stop judging their story. Intercede instead. and simply help them to write a new chapter. And one thing I can tell you from a lot of years of learning what's inside people. When a person is hardest to love, they need your love the most. And that's when you ask Jesus to release his love through you, because your love just isn't enough. React to their bad attitude or their bad treatment, and you can be just another person who just wounds an already wounded person more. I'm going to say that again. When you can't give enough and you feel that you don't have enough love for the person, that's when you ask Jesus to release his love through you, because your love just isn't enough. So react to their bad attitude or their bad treatment, and you can be just another person who just wounds an already wounded person more, because you're going to react to their attitude. Respond with the mercy and the grace and the compassion you receive from Jesus, and you can be part of the healing that wounded person. Everybody's got a story, and you can help them write a new chapter. Remember the opening text. So what's the story behind these ruins? What's the story behind these ruins? You have to remember. What's the story behind these ruins? 1 Kings 9:6-9 in the Message Bible. Everybody has a story behind their ruins. So don't be so quick to respond and react. Likewise, there's more in their story as well. And it will be a beautiful bestseller. What you say, Celine? Happiness come from within. Exactly. Christy, I missed what you said, but I'm going to read it. You can help them with their story, because there's more to their story. And it will be a beautiful bestseller. If only you listen and not judge their story, then let your response and reactions be, let me help you write a new chapter. I'm going to help you. Hi, Cora, Michelle. Everybody got a story to tell. The only problem is finding a person that will listen and care. Every single person on the planet has a story. Don't judge people before you truly know them. The truth might surprise you. Before you judge my life, my past, or my character, walk in my shoes, walk the path I have traveled, live my sorrows, my doubts, my fears, my pains, and my laughter. Remember, everyone has a story. When you live my life, then you can judge me. Don't judge people for their choices, for their children, for their mistakes. They make when you don't know the options they had to choose from. Sometimes people have some options that they had to choose from. It was not their choice. So don't judge people for the choices they make when you don't know the options they had to choose from. Do not judge a person's story by the chapter you walk in on. We cannot judge, and I'm wrapping up. That's the end of my message. We have to stop judging people. We have to stop, and we have to realize, wait, before I say something, I'd be very careful. I don't know what happened in their life. And like I said, it is a difference. There are some people, like I said, they're just needy, and they want to take all your time and attention. You have to be able to discern that. But there are people that are broken. There are people that they need help. They need to get out of that chapter they're stuck in. And that's okay if they get upset with you. People get upset with me all the time. They say I offend them all the time. I'm not trying to offend them. I'm trying to help. I'm trying to help, and I give wisdom of God, Lord, how do I handle it? Because believers are the worst ones that get offended. They get offended more than people in the world. So how can I say something? So I just say, well, if you don't want to hear the truth, don't call me, because I'm going to tell you what God's put on my heart. And it's not to offend, it's to help. So you want to help that person get out of that chapter, because they've been singing that same song for 20 years. It's time for them to move on to the next song, to the next line, the next stanza. It's time for them to get to the next chapter. And you have to say, okay, I'm so, because you can, anytime somebody can repeat your story for you, every time you see them, they can repeat your story. You've told that story too many times. When people can repeat what you're saying, you've told that story too many times. So it's time to help people get past their past. You can't hear anything, Juliana? I don't know. Jordan say I'm live, and I just want to be sure that you all are hearing me. I really want to be sure of that, that you are hearing me, so you let me know, because I don't want you to miss it, and then if so, just come back. But that's my message. I want to encourage you. If you know someone who is, they just need, you know, there have been problems and circumstances and just things. Okay, thank you. Things that you know, they need to hear you. They need to hear somebody to say, let me help you. I may not have a lot of time to help, But I want to help you get past this story. This is not the end of the chapter here. This is not the end of your life. You're not there anymore, so why are you still living that life? You're not even there anymore, but you want to keep dwelling on it. And like I said, some people love that. They love to complain. They love, some people, they do. You say, how is that? Some people just do. That gives them something to do, whatever. But there are people who are really hurting, and all they need is a kind word. Or even if you've been in that same situation, you say, you know what? I can relate. I've been there too. But you know what? I'm going to help you get out of it. And so there are times, if we can even notice a person and see somebody and say, they look like they're just hurting, they're just in need. And you can say something to them and they will share with you what has happened. And I tell you, I didn't know the stats on so many sexually abused women by their spouses. And I mean, I knew many other things. Would you say, don't look in the rearview mirror, the windshield is bigger? Yes, it is. It's bigger. But I found that so many people are just in this area, and I'm quite sure other areas, have had that problem. And I just pray and say, Lord, whatever I can say to help them, whatever I can do to help them, Lord, give me the words to say to help them out of that situation of being abused or mistreated or belittled or whatever it is. So today I just want to say to you, If you're in that situation, I may have someone here that's right there now. I want you to know that we're not going to repeat that chapter anymore. We're going to move forward because God's going to help us. He got a new story for you. He already had it. We were sorry. We forgive. And God said, Jesus said, forgive them 77 times because they did something to you. They hurt you. They abused you. But we'll stay stuck right there. And we can't get right in a relationship. We can't get right in any situation because of what happened to us. So I want you to stretch out today like that crane I was talking about last week and help someone that you believe that's in need and just need to hear a word of encouragement. All they need is just a word of encouragement to help to get to the next phase. Help to get to where they're trying to go. Just a word of encouragement. Be kind. Be compassionate. As I pray for God always, Lord, give me more compassion. Be kind to people, and because we don't know their story. And if we know their story, let us just try to help them get out of that chapter. Let us try to help them get out of that chapter. You'll be amazed. That person will come back to you like my worker that helped me here at the house, the handyman, what he calls himself. Because of things that I shared and things that I didn't belittle him because of his speech impediment or talk about the way he, whatever it was about him. No, I said, this is not the end of your chapter. You're going to get there. I'm going to try to help you get there. Don't feel low about yourself. Don't think that you're not worth anything. Don't think that you're worthless. So today, be an encourager. Be an encourager. And that was a message I wanted to give today. I had another message, but I said, Lord, to say, this is a day. Wednesday's your day of encouragement. Try to encourage someone. Because I look at the world, I listen to people, and people are hurting so. And I listen to their stories. And yes, I listen to their stories. And I pray for them because many of us have gotten past that story. We're over here somewhere else. How God has blessed us and used us. And he's able to use you when you get out of that chapter that you're stuck in. God can use you. So that's my message for today. It's 1:46 and JP gone over like she always does. And I just want to thank you. I want you all to be here. Please be here Saturday. I'm going to be leaving, going out of the country. I'm going to be leaving, going to a conference, prophetic conference in Ireland. And, you know, if God say move to the, go on to over to the UK, we'll do. But I'm going to be there. I saw Grace on here earlier. I'll be joining them for a prophetic conference. I'll be leaving next week. And I want you to be here Saturday so I can share some things with you. I'm going to try to share some things with you from Ireland. And but God is, we're praying that the move of God will be there. So just pray that the move of God is there. And when I come back, I'll be gone for 8 days or so or something like that. And when I come back, I'm going to be preparing myself to get ready for May for our TV broadcast. And I'm going to be doing things that we're going to be bringing some of you in on our gathering. We could bring at least up to 8 or 10 people, I think, in with us so people will see. And those of you who may have testimonies, let me know. But God is doing a great thing. I feel so good. just pumped for him, my zeal for him. So I want you to get excited as well. As God, it may look, this year may have looked bad. Coming into this year may have looked bad, but I'm telling you that latter rain is coming. Your blessings is coming, and you'll be able to talk about it. So thank you. Bless you again with love and happiness. I thank you so much. I'm just trying to see if it's something I forget. Oh, let me greet everybody before I get off of here. Let me do that. I'm about to forget those of you who have joined me today. So I want to thank you, Juliana, Celine from Perry, Georgia, Safraz. And Safraz, no, I haven't forgotten you. We've just been busy, but I'm going to get with you. Linda Walton from Canton, Georgia. We have Celine from Perry, Georgia. Kelly Green from Wisconsin. Juliana again. Juliana, I hope that you can hear something. Please come back and listen if for some reason you wasn't on. Because most people were hearing me and did see me. Thank you, Cora Jett from Memphis, Tennessee. Michelle, Celine again from Perry, Georgia. Christy Williams. Christy, thank you for joining us Wednesday. Yes, would you say too many in the church like that already? And you know Christy. Yes. So we thank you, Christy, for joining us from Wisconsin. Yes. Wilma's from Wisconsin. Once again, Kelly. Well, you say, Kelly, preach it. I'm trying to. Wilma's is on. Devon, Grace is on from Minnesota. Devon is on from Memphis, Tennessee. We got Colleen from New Mexico. We got Tina Stepp from Texas. Yes, when sins run deep, your grace is more. Yes, we have Claudia Mae Harding. Claudia from North Carolina. Yes. Victoria Pittman from Wisconsin. Good that you're on. LaRonda Hightower. Don't know where LaRonda's from, but I thank her for joining us. Yes. Holiness is Christ in me. Yes, Lord. We thank you. I think I have everyone that's on. If I miss anyone, please let me know. Okay, Lord, I need you. Yes. Yes, I think I got everyone. And Geraldine will list everyone that's on. Every hour, I need you. So we thank you again. I pray that you got some nuggets from the message today, something that I said that can help you. We can know how now to react, how to stay in the character, because we don't know what's behind those ruins. And so I just want to thank you again. Have a blessed day. I know I've gone over. Have a blessed day. Geraldine, forgive me. But thank each one of you for coming. Communion is charity. Invite your friends to come. I have a message God has already given me. And I just want to talk to you all before I leave. And asking for prayer as well, and going on the trip, and then you won't miss a message. And so, thank you all. Bless you with love and happiness. God loves you, and I do too. Peace.